What about this for a little bit of wokeness? You might have heard this, but let's double down. Apparently, to call the subject that bases the English language as English is apparently offensive, apparently rooted in colonialism and all the rest of it. Okay. Now, Bella De Berra is the lady we talked to about these things from the IPA. Now, we all understand that we don't want to be offensive. We don't want to be deriding of people's past, First Nations, all of that stuff. But if you happen to speak a certain form of sounds and identify a certain pattern of letters together, they form French, English, Spanish, and lots of... This is how we categorise language, is it not?
This is reality. This is how we categorise language. This is how we communicate. This is the world we live in. But like many academics and like many teachers, the academic who gave this speech at a conference a couple of weeks ago is in thrall to this postmodernist idea that there is no truth, there's no reality, that something like language oppresses, knowledge oppresses. And she's in the business, unfortunately, of actually education. She's the kind of person who is in charge of future generations of Australians and what they learn. And this conference was actually, that talk wasn't one of the worst things at the conference. They also invited Benjamin Law, who complained that everything's too heteronormative. And I kept having to go back to look at this conference and remind myself that it was meant to be about literacy. So while Australian children are barely able to read and write and falling behind the international cohorts in literacy, these people are spending their time and taxpayers' money talking about feminist readings of sexuality and the English language being oppressive. It's ridiculous, as the Education Minister, Alan Tudge, pointed out.
But what I love about all of these people is that they will all sit inside the structures that they fundamentally hate because it gives them the title, the prestige, and the money, right? Now, if they were a free-thinking person outside of these institutions who never sought to be part of them or to use their powers, then you know what? I'd say you're a fair dinkum person who's willing to say, the whole thing's screwed, let me explain how, let me explain why. Instead, they want to use all of the very systems that they want to pull apart to advance their own professional and ideological causes. That's what sends me nuts. It's like, you know, the senator who refuses to, a senator who goes in. We all know Lydia Thorpe, of course, the Green senator, who was, you know, twixt and twained about whether she should give the oath or not. But, of course, when she was told that's the only way you can formally become a senator, bang, she did it straight away and then spent the rest of the time whinging about white people. That's my issue. What do these people lose? They lose nothing in pursuit of their intellectual goal, using the power, using the structures that they say are the oppressors' structures.
That's an interesting point, actually, because they talk a lot about power. And actually, by not teaching Australian children how to read and write, they're disempowering them. Mm-hmm. So they're all about power and this kind of thing, but they're actually doing the opposite. They're damaging Australian children. And that really annoys me, too, that the hypocrisy of someone like this academic who is the assistant dean at University of Melbourne, who will be on a significant amount of taxpayer money to give talks in English in a language she says is oppressive, and not see the irony of the and not see the hypocrisy of her situation. And this is so common across the board.
Yeah.
Because as you say, they've got nothing to lose. And interestingly, they will deconstruct every institution in this country except university, because it's the university that gives them their their employee. So, you know, everything else has to go, but the university has to stay.
Yeah, correct. I find this stuff. And also, look, I want a society where you can wonder out loud, all right? And that means, postmodern sort of thought bubbles like this stuff where, you know, is a tree really a tree, or have you been told it's a tree? You can tell I went to university for a small amount of time and did a bit of humanities work. But also, you know, I want free thinking, okay? So nobody's suggesting it needs to be shut down. But, geez, we can always draw a pretty straight line from a crazy story that everyone says is no chance of ever happening, like this, to a debate, to a push, to a, if you're against this, then somehow you're a, you know, genocidal maniac. That's why we talk about these stories when they're in their embryonic phase, because that's the thing, Bella. They float the idea and then they get people to nod to the idea, and then the idea ends up becoming a snowball. And despite the fact that it was a dumb idea to start with, it's harder to oppose when it gets that momentum of its own.
Or the idea ends up in the national curriculum, which we've just been talking about in the last few months. So it's not. It is a snowball. It's actually been written into our radical national curriculum by ACARA. So it has already got to the point where it's become a reality and a danger. And we must make sure that it doesn't get through.
All right. Well, thank you for using the oppressive language for me to understand the issues that we are dealing with here this evening. And we look forward to reading and seeing plenty more of you in the next little while. Good on you, Bella.
Thanks so much.
Bella De Brera. Rockstar from the IPA.